ado, I'll turn it over to David.
Thank you all. So I guess everyone went through that door, right? Because it's kind of tilting this way. So I don't know where, I just kind of go this way. I'm glad to be back. I'm one of the guys who keeps coming into the communities. Mike comes in and drops bombs and walks away. or writes it in his column. But Mike and I have a really, really strong working relationship. I think we talk almost every day, and we talk about anything under the sun, and I'll spout off. He said, those are some good ideas. I need to write a column about that. And then, so I claim credit for maybe half the columns he writes out there, because we talk through these issues a lot. This is a presentation, as Mark mentioned, that we gave in here, 2019?
Yep.
Gosh, almost exactly 4 years ago now. I think it was this time of year.
April.
And of course, a lot has changed since then. You'll see some of the data. Some of the data is still the same. Again, we're doing more of a statewide view of things, but it's very, very relevant to Tipton County. I think we have one slide that's Tipton County specific toward the end. But we have a lot of new information that really reinforces what we were talking about 4 years ago. It's just new information. Mike and I, we try to give this talk together. Rarely do we do, so it's always a special treat that when we can do it together and we were able to work it out that we did it again in Tipton County. Usually we're off on our own. He'll go to some group and I'll go to some group. So we really enjoy doing that together. So I'll kick things off, and again, for those of you who remember this, it's very, very heavy on data. So we like that because it's kind of quantitative proof of what we're talking about. So we're going to talk about these things, and I'm just going to move on. One thing we always like to point out, Mike is the director of the Center for Business and Economic Research, the research arm. Two economists and a sociologist embedded. Technically works for ICI, but he's the research arm. And I'm the director of the Indiana Communities Institute. We're in the engagement arm. And we really practice this model, the policy practice of research. We do provide a lot of policy advice in state government levels, but also at community levels. We're talking to the lieutenant governor and to agency directors quite often about how we see things. We still do a lot of program development for the state agencies, some federal inputs, and then we also have strong partnerships with groups like AIM, the Advancing Indiana Municipalities. We run the Mayor's Institute with AIM, where we talk to a ton of mayors across the state. State Chamber, Mike and I were just talking about some of the work with the State Chamber. So we do have broad perspectives on how we look at things. So this looks familiar. This is a traditional approach to economic development. It has been used and still is used across the state. This probably looks familiar to a lot of people in Tipton County. You know, I've been working in Tipton County, people know, for the last 3 years, but in my previous lives, I've been in and around Tipton County for close to 15 years. And I know this has been a traditional approach, how people have seen how they maybe measure progress in our counties based on luring investments and jobs and incentives and things like that. So these are still some local policies we're seeing around the state. And there are some assumptions with this. These policies were all developed and programs were all developed 40 years ago or so. And at that time, there were assumptions, and probably good assumptions at the time. But one of the assumptions was manufacturing drives employment. That that's an assumption. That's still there a lot, that manufacturing drives employment in our communities. And that was an assumption that maybe has some validity at the time. The other one is that growth of property tax base, and it assumes that with this business, all this business attraction, Stellantis out on the highway, with this business attraction, we'll have growth in our property tax base. And then the other big assumption is with the job growth, with all these jobs coming in, we'll have all these people moving in. So we're gonna have data basically saying so much has changed that all these assumptions really aren't valid anymore. These really aren't valid. At the time manufacturing, at the time of the policy development, manufacturing may have been the driver of employment. That's not the case in Indiana anymore. There's one county, I think, that it could be, Elkhart County. They are 49%, their employment base is 49% manufacturing. The rest of the state's around 15%. And in most rural counties, it's around 20%. We'll show you the data on that. Regarding the property tax base, that had relative validity in terms of growth of property tax base, especially personal property tax. That all changed with property tax caps. With property tax caps, you saw a growth of income tax revenue being more important than it was. So pre-property tax caps, Tracy's nodding, you're nodding your head, you know all this. You probably live it every day. Pre-tax caps, property tax revenue was about 90% of all local revenues. Since tax caps, it's anywhere, depending on the county, it's income tax is local income tax is 30 to 40% of all local revenue. Still, property tax is the majority of the revenue, but you kind of see the income tax curve going up. And the property tax revenue going, staying relatively flat across the board. And there's two ways to grow your local revenues with income tax without raising the tax. Any ideas? Grow your population, have higher per capita income. Grow your population, have higher per capita income, because the income tax goes to the place of residence, not the place of employment. It goes to the place of residence. So that leads to the job growth and population growth. We'll show some evidence there that will actually go here. The revenue mix has changed. I forgot about this slide. And actually, manufacturing employment is in permanent decline. I've already talked about that. Evidence, and we have some new information on this. COVID had rapidly accelerated and accentuated the employment mix in our communities. COVID has done that. It's not a blip. There's a sign of permanence there. And the big thing is people choose where they want to live based on quality of life. The evidence is clear on that, and we'll show that to you. But when you look back at these policies that are still there that are oriented to this, we're working with a lot of communities to sort out, and actually even at the state level, how do we reframe that discussion? And a lot of the work that the Community Foundation has been doing is helping, and a lot, I think, within Tipton County, on a broad scale, just helping to reframe that discussion as well. So that's where it is now, and this is where Mike will go through a lot of the data supporting what we just talked about.
And Mark, feel free to, if anybody, if you want to share this with anybody, feel free to do so. So you don't have to take pictures of the slides. Not a lot of people pull out their phones and take pictures. What David described is a natural economic evolution, this movement away from manufacturing as a shared employment. So if you're my vintage, so you were born 60 years ago, you remember about 1 in 3 Americans were factory workers. And they moved to where factory work was. And that's the model we're stuck with, right? Today it's about 8% of the population, less than that. It's been declining for 75 years. And just let me ask, does anybody know when peak manufacturing production was? What year? Anybody guess? In the United States? In the 70s?
What? Mid-80s.
Mid-80s? That was when the best music was, not any ideas? No, the answer is 2021. Inflation-adjusted manufacturing production in the United States peaked in 2021. The year before that was 2018, the year before that was 2017, the year before that was 2016. We are a manufacturing powerhouse, right? On a per capita basis, for a per worker basis, nobody manufactures anything like we do, right? Now let me ask, when was manufacturing employment peak in the United States? Yeah, you bracket it, the answer is August of 1979. Pretty good music that year too, right? Here in Indiana, it was 1973. So we're really good at manufacturing, so we're going to need fewer workers to do that. The manufacturing share of employment peaked in the 1930s when we started gathering data. If we don't count the guys and gals who went to World War II, maybe it was 1945, but as a share of employment, if you include military, it peaked just before the Great Depression. We're really good at making stuff, so we can make more without using more people. So as a source of employment, which is what David's talking about, manufacturing doesn't work really well for most places. And this is not something that you can tweak with public policy. It comes about from fundamental economic changes. So we have data here on household consumption from 1929 to very recently, 2017, 2019. And what this shows is that if you go back to the Great Depression, about 2/3 of household income was spent on manufactured goods, either food, clothing, housing, automobiles, that newfangled radio, that sort of stuff. By the mid-60s, household consumption shifted, so it was now 50% manufactured goods and 50% services. So services are things like the restaurant that prepares your food, the movie theater, the recreational location, the third grade school teacher, those are services. And by just before COVID, it was 69-70% services. There was a big goods jump in 2020 because we bought stuff and made it at home and we couldn't travel. But that trend is gonna continue, so the household spending will probably be 10, 12, 15% by 2050 on manufactured goods. The price drops for them. We have a lot more stuff, right? It looks like we have a lot of stuff, but we're really spending money on services. And so this is a fundamental economic scenario that's not going away. People aren't gonna say, gosh, I'd really like to go back and spend half my earnings on goods. So the demand for goods and the demand for labor to produce those goods isn't going to shock upwards at any time in the near future. We're talking about an 80-year economic trend, right? And there are several reasons for this, right? One of them is this capital-to-labor ratio. So economists like to think, and if you're doing property taxes, you should care about this, is that it's how, for $1 million of today's inflation-adjusted dollars, how many jobs do I get to my community? Well, we started gathering this data in 1947 all the way through. I think the most recent that I've looked at is like 2018. And in the 1940s, if you bought $1 million worth of equipment, business, personal property to a community, to a factory in 1947, it's today's dollars, you got about 22 jobs with that. Today, you get 3.
So let me interject here. When those policies were created around here, there was somewhat of a correlation between investment and job creation. And I'm talking about tax abatement, tax increment, and financing, things like that. And so there was validity to that until the 80s. That we still continue with those policies and those programs, but now things like abatement over time, basically we're incentivizing capital to replace workers. It's an unintended consequence. It's not on purpose. But the other thing, element of that is we have no other tools. That's kind of what we're stuck with.
Right, so great, you know, Governor talked about the great work that IEDC did in 2022, record investment, $22 billion they brought in that year. Manufacturing employment has been going down for 8 months. What do you think that, you incentivize that capital, what do you do with it? Right, so there's a really strong evidence that the incentivization of manufacturing has led to an accelerated automation of that industry. Right? Makes it more efficient, makes it more profitable, you just need less people doing it. So as a jobs machine, manufacturing isn't going to do it. By the way, this is the picture of that in the Midwest. I have three pictures of tomato production. The upper left-hand corner there is the 1920s, right? Really low capital to labor ratio. It's a big wooden pole barn, benches, buckets, knives, sharpening stones. Right, and people processing cooked tomatoes. Very low capital to labor ratio. 1950s, those women were replaced by these women in frock, you know, uniform frocks, and they were picking out tomatoes, and they were going through a processing machine to be canned. Much higher capital to labor ratio. That third graphic is in the 2000s. And this was the hard picture to find. The other two were real easy to find on the internet because I wanted to find, I needed a denominator for my equation. That's the way economists think, right? I needed a person, not just the capital, and there's actually a person here in a little red tomato-looking uniform, right? So that's the factory that you're getting now. Really productive, makes a lot of stuff, doesn't need a lot of people with it. That is not going to go away. Right, so this isn't something that you can change with a law or you can change with a trade deal, right? That has nothing to do with trade. In fact, we export about $100 billion worth of food to China every year. So those tomatoes are going to, from Elwood to China or Elwood to Canada, right? Two of my least favorite countries. And so that's an economic fundamental that's caused this problem. And here's the big shocker, because it ties back to that first public policy that we had, right? We have two types of jobs. We call them footloose jobs or global jobs. These are jobs that you can do anywhere, right? Because you're making something that's primarily being exported somewhere else. So if you're making a car in Kokomo, there's some people at Kokomo may buy a GM product, but most of that stuff's going somewhere else. So that's a job that could be done anywhere. Those are footloose jobs, because you could attract them using the business tax incentives and the economic development policies that David talked about in our third slide. The other type of job is the non-footloose job, and those jobs have to be done around people. Those are jobs where local presence really matters. So this graphic goes up through 2017, 2018. The United States, since 1969, has been a job creation machine. That's the year we started gathering county-level data, so I'd like to use that. We've been a job creation machine, right? Over 100 million new jobs created since 1970. Negative 5 or 6 million of the footloose jobs. So those policies that say we need to attract manufacturing or its sister logistics, we need to bring people to the community that's going to cause us to be prosperous. Well, folks, this is what they're chasing, right? This is the economic development target. a business attraction. And that's okay, right? But if you're moving, our point today will reinforce this, we're okay with business attraction. Indiana's good at it, right? Our point is it doesn't matter an awful lot for prosperity for most communities.
It's like a, I describe it like a giant game of whack-a-mole. If you're successful bringing in a plant, somewhere else there are jobs being destroyed. There are plants shutting down. It's a national game of whack-a-mole. So more success, more power to you if you're able to attract a company. But we also need to understand that at some point, it's the nature of the beast. At some point, those jobs are destroyed. It could be in 10 years, it could be 50 years, that they will be destroyed. We need to understand that. I live in Southern Indiana. I located in Southern Indiana with a plant, with a company. Got all kinds of incentives in 1990. That plant was shut down in 2010. I mean, these things happen. These things happen. And we need to understand that on a broader level in our communities. It's not a bad thing if you attract a company and have jobs. Understand the realities. That's really kind of what we're saying.
And be very cautious about how you do it, because if you're using public policy at all to attract jobs, which you necessarily are, right, you're doing something in government, something with local government, with zoning or land use planning, it's likely that you're taking resources away from this, attracting these types of jobs, in order to attract these types of jobs, right? You're saying, I'm going to incentivize to try to get a factory to get one of those, which you might get, right? You might get some of that. Just because there's fewer of them doesn't mean some places aren't going to get some in the normal churn of manufacturing and logistics. But if I'm taking resources from things that could attract these more permanent jobs, which come with people, in order to get the more transient jobs that come with a factory, or a warehouse, or an Infosys headquarters, or anything like that, you're making a big policy risk, right? Big policy risk. And this really, I think, depicts it pretty well, right? Indiana manufacturing employment, this is the share of manufacturing. We're the most manufacturing intensive state in the union. We've done it better than anybody else, and look what's happened to us.
We're down now just about 15%, 16%.
Right.
If total employment in Indiana, manufacturing 6%, 16% of that. What does this look like?
Decline.
Huh? Sorry?
Decline.
Yeah. What other industry does it look like? You're in the middle of it. I'm sorry? That's part of manufacturing.
Yeah.
Agriculture.
Right. So this is farming in the 1940s. In the 1930s, right? Peak share of agriculture employment in the U.S. happened before 1900. Right. So, and by the way, what was the record ag year in the U.S. for production? It's now. It's probably happening this year. Right.
And setting aside the Great Recession, yes, this is factors in COVID a little bit. But we've gone from almost 700,000 jobs in manufacturing to just over 500,000 jobs. That's a 20% drop.
Yes. And just to let you know also, if you're my vintage, you think of factory jobs as really good jobs for people. They really are oftentimes high-paying jobs, both for people who are college graduates. In 2007 was the year where half of all factory workers had been to college. Since 2009, Indiana has had pretty steady growth. It's not a huge recovery. We're not back to 2007 numbers, and we never will be ever again. Right? There'll probably be almost certainly fewer factory workers in Indiana 2030 than there are now. But do you know what the educational composition of the biggest growth of this? if you look at education, either college graduates, been to college, high school graduates, or dropouts, what's the biggest share of that recovery? The number one share. Any idea?
High school.
No. We're nowhere near high school graduates in manufacturing we were in 1997. Nope, not some college. We're still not back to pre-2007 levels in some college. It's both of those two. The number one is college, high school dropouts. That's where we've seen the majority growth in manufacturing.
You're talking about Indiana.
In Indiana.
Yeah, we have a graph.
Oh, do we have a graph? We don't have... Oh yeah, that's right. Sorry, we updated this. These have not been great jobs. Great jobs for those workers, not necessarily good employment options for the community.
Yeah, that and the next one. This is a scary one.
Right. So this shows this century, right? And this is a busy graph. So what we have here are the monthly wages of jobs, right? The bubble size is the amount of earnings. So it's the number of people times the average wage. And this is the employment change in this century in manufacturing in Indiana. Right? So all those red bubbles are lost income. So it's income, we're losing our high wage factory jobs.
And high numbers.
And big numbers, right? So look at, like, this one is
8,000.
Primary metal manufacturing. Yeah. This is transportation equipment. That's automobiles. This is leather. No, that's non-metallic mineral product manufacturing. 20,000 jobs, 30,000 jobs lost, big income jobs. Here's where we've gained jobs in factories in Indiana, right? This is a fairly high wage job. Petroleum and coal products manufacturing. That's 2021. You know how many coal miners we have in Indiana right now? They've doubled. About 2,000, right. So there are more people professionally walking dogs in Indianapolis than there are coal miners in Indiana. Chemical manufacturing, that's a pretty good paying job. This is value-added agriculture, right? So when you hear we're gonna be a great place for value-added agriculture, that's taking the squeak out of the pig. It's a very good thing to do. I like making more than the next guy. But they're not generally, particularly if they cluster, good jobs for a community. Beverage, tobacco product manufacturing. Those are the brew pubs that you get in India right there. And then textile mills is a small part. That's a scary graphic. So when you hear about how great we are in business attraction, how many jobs we're creating in that area, it's this stuff is where we're seeing it. Very, very difficult. Yes.
What is the national picture of this?
Same, but we're bigger manufacturing share. So if you're in Massachusetts, you lost your factory jobs 75 years ago, right? If you're in New York, if you're in Eastern New York, you lost your factory jobs 75 or 100 years ago. If you're Western New York, they're like us. So the Rust Belt, really, I hate to use the term, but there it is, from Western New York all the way out to Iowa, looks like this, right? And this, by the way, we've replaced those jobs, right? These jobs are being replaced by higher paying jobs in a different sector. They just require more education, right? So Hoosier incomes have gone up. So it's not that we have more jobs today in Indiana right now than we've ever had before. It's just not in factories and they pay well. The problem is that's, as we're trying to argue, is our economic development policies, $1 billion a year in at least in Indiana is going towards trying to fix that, and it can't. It just cannot. Because there are economic forces driving that are beyond control here. This is
the chart that maybe explains the bubble charts a little bit more.
Right. These are the number of the
jobs
rows,
yeah.
Right, and the wages, the monthly wages.
So we're replacing, $5,000 monthly, $8,400 monthly, with $4,700 monthly, around $4,000 monthly. We're replacing really high wage jobs with really low wage jobs. And so that translates to maybe to $40,000, $48,000 annually. That might be okay, but you're going from, and that's on average though, but you're going from 60 to 90,000 dollar jobs.
So basically these jobs here in this category that David's talking about, right, well, under 4,000 a year, that's what, 42,000, 44,000, with 47 right. It's higher. That's about 200% of the poverty level. So if you track that person with, if that's a family of four with two kids, their children get free and reduced lunch at your school. Right? Nothing wrong with, I mean, noble work, fine work. We're talking about public policy, about community development. Right? So if you don't have a high school diploma, the best thing you do is get a good paying job, teach your skills, get your responsibility. So I want to see more people working. It's not a criticism of the people doing the work, it's a criticism of the policy that says we expect prosperity by chasing this. That's just not gonna happen. That's the point. There's not good or bad jobs necessarily, but if you're spending money to get these jobs, don't expect your community to become affluent in the world. Here's a couple of graphics here. This is just, I used this in a study to try to make an appeal to public policymakers at the state level about why this sort of problem needs to be changed. In the United States, this is U.S. cumulative job growth by education from the end of the Great Recession up through COVID, right?
So the last 10 to 15 years.
Right. And by the way, this looks the same if you go back to the 1970s. It didn't really matter. I just wanted to use something recent here. You can see about 80%, and this turns out, it translates to about 80% of the job growth in the United States has been to men and women who have a bachelor's degree or higher. About 20% to folks who have been to college or have an associate's degree. The data doesn't make a clear distinction there. So almost 100% of jobs for the past 40 years have gone to people who graduated, have gone to college. And for net employment growth in all the other sectors is zero or negative. So there's still jobs in there, but they're just churning. You're just replacing retirees, essentially. There's no job growth in those areas. If you look at Indiana, they have exactly the opposite story, right? And this is average monthly data. This is 1 month in each, so it's highly cyclical, right? So that's why each quarter, there's a lot of quarterly variation in it, right? Same time period, this is quarterly data, that's annualized data, and what you see is our job growth is high school dropouts. These are formal jobs, not informal jobs. They're not the Amish. There's about 62,000 Amish in Indiana. It's up from 56,000 in 2010, right? So the job growth in those areas is not that. Now, I will say we don't have a graph here in post-COVID, and why this is worrisome is, right, that means the composition of employment here is slipping rather badly. These folks generally are not gonna pay near the taxes that they get in public benefits, right, they're low income, so that's a real challenge for Indiana. Here's the high school, the college graduate numbers here at the bottom. The lowest proportional growth. That changed during COVID. So if I were to update this graphic to 2022, which I don't have the 22 days, the 21 data, it's now spiked, it's now college graduates.
So it's college graduates and less than high school.
Right, those are the two big areas.
That goes back to the reason that the job growth is there, that's because that's what we produce. On a state level, I'm not talking about our individual schools, but what we have in our community is a workforce that the companies we attract, it is commanded by the workforce we offer. Does that make sense? The companies we attract is commanded by the workforce we offer, and that's the reason that is like that.
Yeah, the dirty little secret is this is our fault. This isn't IEDC's fault. It's not your business attraction community's fault. It's the fault that this is the workforce that's available, right? And so we're going to get only those jobs that where the workforce is available. And I know, you know, when we travel around the state, we hear people say, oh, IEDC is biased because all those good jobs go to Hamilton County and all the bad jobs come to my county. Right? And we pull up the educational attainment and say, well, that's because that's where the workers for the good jobs live, and they're not going to move to your county. That's not the story I'm going to tell here. A very different story here. But that's a real challenge for much of the state, is that we're not producing the labor force that we need. And we're reactive to those businesses that complain about labor supply, right? Because you never hear anybody say, I just don't have enough PhDs or masters or bachelor's. Have you ever heard that problem? Has any company ever gone to IEDC and said, I don't have enough people in STEM degrees to work in my factory? You never hear that. Why? Because those businesses are, IEDC is irrelevant. Right, so you're getting a very biased response amongst policymakers because they're only hearing from the companies that are dissatisfied with those middle skill job or sort of training.
So
yes.
So I was going to say, so in terms of nationally, the jobs and the industries that are driving BA plus versus less than high school here, can you comment on the difference in those employers?
Right, well, they're more, if you look at big industries, the question was, what jobs are driving this, right? Mm-hmm. So we buy more services, right? So services can be increasingly exported. We're gonna talk a lot about that going, because remote work ends up being a lot of remote services. We'll talk about that near the end of the talk. But, you know, the major areas in which the rest of the country is growing is gonna be in information technology, in science, in those types of occupations. Mm-hmm. And we just don't have the labor force to attract those businesses here. We have plenty of smart people in Indiana, right? They're not being educated the same way they are nationally, right? So they can't demonstrate that capacity, and the businesses aren't coming here as a consequence.
So what kind of jobs are we attracting here in Indiana?
Value-added agriculture.
Lower-end manufacturing.
Right. Manual production of recreational vehicles, assembly plants, those sorts of things.
It's essentially employers and industries. This is more manufacturing heavy. It's employers and industries that haven't automated yet.
That's exactly the perfect way to say it. They're the ones who haven't automated yet. They will automate. As soon as these folks start getting paid too much, they'll automate it. Because you automate the cheap jobs last, right? So, well, we've just been through the biggest decline in human capital in Indiana's history, right? In formal education, except it's still ongoing, right? So I got two graphics here. This is the absolute gap in educational attainment going back to World War II. In Indiana. So this, back in the 1940s and even the 1950s, we were about like the nation as a whole. The difference between Indiana that had a 1% difference or a 5 or this point percentage relative to 20% was just because of the size of a few cities. Most people who were college graduates were either distributed evenly because they were your physicians and school teachers, or they were clustered in urban places. And so we've been our absolute gap sort of recovered in the 1990s. This is the percentage gap, right? Started to recover, and after 2010 has collapsed, right? So in the last decade plus, the share of this is bachelor's degrees, right? And relative to the nation as a whole has collapsed. And the problem with this is none of this captures the collapse in go-to-college rates that began in 2015, right? So in 2015, Indiana was about 8% below the national average in the share of our young people who went to college. National average was 73, we were 65%. From 2015 to 2019, we dropped under 60%, and then COVID drove us down to 53%. So we are now sending kids to college at about 20 percentage points below where the nation was in 2015. We're about 15 points below the national average now because everybody got walloped by COVID. But these data don't pick that up because that's the year those kids, right? These are fall years. Those kids haven't graduated yet. So that relative decline is now much worse and will be much worse for 40 years if that's not reversed fairly quickly. That cohort, you can't get back. We're not getting them back in school. It's future cohorts that are a real problem. So this fact reinforces the trend from the earlier slide about where the types of jobs we're gonna get into the end. So we published a study just to try to explain how vulnerable these jobs were, how many places in the country were at risk of losing jobs in factories, in part because when you're attracting a factory, you're also introducing risk of automation or trade in a way that you're not if you're a service-based sector, at least you had been, right? So I'm going to show you maps here in a minute. Offshoring tends to see, we offshore its trade, jobs go away, a whole factory closes because that business usually doesn't move overseas. I think economists have had a hard time finding more than three or four factories that have actually picked up and gone overseas. All we do is buy stuff from overseas and close our domestic factories. It's a nice story, there's just not any fact behind it. It's kind of like mermaids. It's entertaining but not truthful. Automation is the real problem. But when we do see offshoring, we see import substitution where trade causes jobs to go, the whole factory goes. When we see automation, what we see is employment shrinking rapidly in a factory. And so we lose about two-thirds of, typical factory lose about two-thirds of jobs. The remaining jobs are higher paid, better educated workers, but there's a big loss to workers with fewer options, right? And so we talked a lot about this because we think it's important in almost everything we do in the Midwest, because Indiana is the largest at-risk state for automation related job losses. This is a picture of the Midwest. On the left here, the redder this gets, the worse the automation risk is. These are the share of jobs that in 2012 there was a available digital or machine or robot that could eliminate that job being used somewhere in the developed world. So these aren't like magical AI job creator, job destroyers, or futuristic robots. These are things that are already there, right? And just to put that in context, the world's number one robotics hub in the world, the most robots per person is right there in Toledo. And that's the most robotic intensive metropolitan area in the world. We're real close behind that in South Bend, right? And here, the same thing, this is offshoring risk. What I invite you to do is look at the scale, right? The scale of offshoring risk, so these are the share of jobs. They go up to about just under 1 in 3 jobs are at risk of being offshore. Here, it's 2 out of every 3 jobs. So Indiana has, of the top 25 counties for automation risk, we have 7 or 8 counties that are top 25 out of 3,144 counties. We're the number one state. So those jobs that we've been bringing in factories are at extraordinary risk of automation. The logistics jobs that we've been bringing in are even at greater risk of automation.
So Tipton County is a white county, or a gray county. That's still half the jobs in Tipton County are vulnerable to automation.
Right.
It's not like up in Northeast Indiana, but there's still a big vulnerability to automation.
Right, so you guys in both of these, right, they're a quarter of automation or of jobs could be outsourced and half of jobs could be automated. That's pre-COVID. The landscape's changed a little bit. It's added more people to the risk of automation, primarily. More accelerated risk. So we don't know what this is going to be. We don't know how many jobs are going to be lost. We don't know how many are going to be transitioned. We do know that if you accelerate this by incentivizing automation, right? You may keep some of the production there, but you're also displacing workers at a faster rate than the normal economy would entail. A colleague of mine, Amanda Weinstein, wanted to also look at, you know, what are the places that are the most recession-proof? And so the Bureau of Labor Statistics keeps data on every metro area and the types of occupations that they have, and they have lists of skills that are stuck into these occupations, right? So as an economist, I have a certain set of skills that I have to have. If you're a truck driver, we have a different set of skills. And they're all put into three categories: cognitive-based skills, which is really math and science and problem solving; people-based skills, which is mostly customer service and leadership and management, working in teams; and then the third one are manual skills. That's making stuff or doing things with your hands, right? So most jobs have some of that, of each of those, right? But there's one that is dominant. Every occupation has one of those areas that is dominant. And so what she did was just map those places over time into three categories: the high motor skills, and then the high people skills and high cognitive skills, and she looked at the unemployment rate of the average metro area over time.
And that was through the Great Recession.
Right, so this is 1970 through 2012, so Amanda and Carly and Patrick did this really great study just illustrating that if you're really focusing on attracting these jobs, then you're importing volatility into your economy. Right, which again is a problem because volatility means people are less likely to start a business, less likely to open a coffee shop, less likely to want to live there.
Yeah,
because
so you see one of the first big peaks with Ted Anderson, early 80s.
Right. Right, that's the last time we went through a Federal Reserve-induced business cycle like we're potentially at risk for now.
Right.
Not as bad, because we just don't have 40% of our people working in factories. We're down to 15%. Right. We also, the federal government also asked people, why do you move to a place? And they asked in the American Housing Survey, started doing 1917, was job, marriage, military orders took me someplace. Didn't even ask about quality of place, didn't ask about schools, didn't ask any of that stuff. Because if anyone lives in the 1970s knows, all schools were identical, right? There was no difference. There was no internet to check the facts about it. In the 1980s, we started asking questions about schools and other public services. These are a bunch of questions. Back in the 1970s, the first one, 1972, right, the Nixon era beginning of this, that number was at about 25%. It already dropped by the mid-1980s to about 12%. This is schools and public services, right? Now, I have my hypothesis as to why this hit at the beginning this was taken during 2007 in a housing crisis across most of the country. So I don't judge that change right there. I think it probably should just be a continuum, right? The real reason we think this is that availability, and during this time particular, between here and here, schools were required to test and make comparable performance measures. So then we had this new thing called the internet that not everybody was using back in here, right? But by then everybody was using. That gave us extraordinary information about our communities, right? If you moved someplace in 1999, if you looked at the internet, every chamber of commerce just said, they said the same thing, right? Yeah, great, it's a great place to live, low crime, great schools, family friendly neighborhood. They all say that today, but nobody looks at them, they look at some other website that has data about it. So we now know a lot about the places we can live.
So this is the first evidence. First of all, we talk about changing generational change in this attitude, but it's also evidence that people pay attention to where they want to live, and really kind of the first evidence that jobs follow people.
Yep.
Yeah, I think I have the next couple of slides.
You did?
Yes, I did. So, kind of reinforcing that if jobs follow people, then what do people want? And that requires a whole different mindset of engagement and how communities operate. And so there are a couple of qualitative studies that kind of stick out there that are standing the test of time. One is University of Wisconsin, and did this huge study in their state, and they asked wanted to determine what are the most important qualities of the community. So if people live where they're gonna live, what are the most important qualities? And if you ever read any of Mike's columns, about every fifth one is about school quality. And it's reinforced there. People pay attention to schools. People pay attention to schools. And we can go on the rest of the night talking about that. We won't. But then the other one is housing, but it's the appropriate affordability of housing and diversity of housing opportunities. It's not just single family homes on a quarter acre lot. It's all kinds of different housing opportunities and outdoor amenities. And here's an important element that is a thread in a lot of the research, and some of the work we're doing for Okra kind of points this out as well. Civic engagement and a sense of belonging are incredibly important to people. The ability to engage in a community are incredibly important. And the other one introduces the regional concept that you don't have to have everything to everybody, for everybody, but you have to have proximity to other opportunities. Tipton County is wonderfully situated in a lot of ways for that, wonderfully situated. It's kind of grabbing that genie in the bottle kind of thing. Anyway.
Yeah, so we did a study in Indiana, right, because we wanted, one of the rural problems in America focus on those plain states where you drive 5 hours between cities the size of Muncie. Here in Indiana, 85% of folks live within a 20-minute drive of an urban county. So we're a very compact state. There's a lot of accessibility. There's almost no place in Indiana that commuting times would strike somebody who lived in the coasts as unusual. I went to high school inside the Washington, D.C. Beltway, right? You could get a school bus and get it from here to downtown Indianapolis at about the same time it often took me to go 6 or 7 miles. I walked home a lot of times and could beat the school bus in traffic. And so that you know, we have a very compact state, which completely changes the opportunities around, and this is pre-COVID. The post-COVID numbers I'll show you in a minute are really even more stark. Oh, this is yours.
That's fine. So place attachment is, this is something that's intrigued me, and it kind of goes back to that Wisconsin study. Place attachment is the strong emotional bond to community that we have. We know that studies show that strong place attachment correlates with GDP growth, productivity growth in a community, and population growth. We can't say it's causal, but there's a correlation. Wherever you see that attachment, you see these variables at play here. We also know, going back to that engagement, residents with strong place attachment don't want to leave their communities. They don't want to leave their communities, even if things are bad for them. And so the Knight Foundation did this huge study, a landmark study that still has legs. They wanted to find out what were those elements of the place attachment. So they did a comprehensive survey of 43,000 respondents in 26 cities, and it took 3 years to do this. It's a huge study. And the top three components of elements of place attachment were social offerings, things for people to do in the community. Openness, and that's transparency in government, that's the ability to be involved in community, and aesthetics. What does our community look like? Is there community pride reflected on how our community looks? I have a story about that when I moved to southern Indiana. I moved with the factory that happened to be a Japanese-owned company. And I'll never forget the experience of walking on the town square with the president from Tokyo, walking the mayor around town. And at the time, that community was struggling. And there was trash on the sidewalks and weeds on the sidewalks, and some of the storefronts didn't look good. And the president looked at the mayor and said, "Have you no pride in this community?" this really happened. This really happened. Having no pride in this community. And he said, I'm bringing my workers here, from my officers from Japan, and they have to live in this community, having no pride. I'll never forget that. How, I just wanted to slink away. But, I mean, that literally happened. And the mayor actually did a 180 in terms of that stuff, and got a lot of activity going, but that goes to that. That goes to that. The fourth characteristic is good schools. The good schools, again, are high up there. But this quality of life, quality of place is incredibly, I mean, the data support quality of place in terms of this population growth and productivity.
Yeah, I won't take too much time with this because this is going to be important to Tipton County, and there's a lot of stuff written on this, but we economists measure quality of life very differently than everybody else, because we don't know what your preferences are, we don't know what you like, and so we want to just see what people do. How do they behave? How do markets explain quality of life? So we develop a very, very much like a stock market price. Stock price tells you what you need to know about that company. You don't need to do a lot of research, just look at the stock price on that company. So we did the same thing here. We looked at home prices in every U.S. county that had data, about 3,082 out of the 3,144. And if you control for all the factors that would explain those home prices, so you create a statistically identical home in every U.S. county, then if people are willing to pay more for that home, that's a better community. The people who live there and the people who choose not to live there are weighing in on it, and they're paying more than that house should be worth in an average U.S. county. That's a good place to be. If they're paying less for it, that's a bad place, right? It's at the margin. The economy's been doing this for about 40 years. And our value is we were able to do this at the county level, not at the individual, at the metropolitan area level. The second thing is jobs. It's the same thing, right? That if I'm a worker and you can create a statistically identical worker in every place, the place where somebody's willing to move to, that they're taking a little bit of a pay cut, not a big pay cut, just a marginal pay cut, that's in a nicer place. You have to have a premium to live in that place. So here's how that works out in the real world. For realtors, it's always location, location, location. So everybody gets the real estate. How, just school quality alone explains her 30% of home variation in Indiana, right? Just school quality. You go from a C school to an A school, same home, 30% price difference. Just like that, instantly. So I always tell people, well, how can I raise your tax base? Get better schools. So automatic, it bleeds through into assessments and appraisals. That makes sense. When we published this in a paper, we published it with Brookings Institution in the Midwest. Richard Florida weighed in on it, right? And on Twitter, he said, I'm buying a house in Traverse City, which was the fastest growing county in the Midwest at the time, and it had the highest quality of place. And then another colleague, and he said, that's great, I'm buying a home there, I really love this study, and he tweeted it out, it went on its way. I got a call about an hour later from a buddy of mine in Michigan. He said, I finally see what you've been trying to describe, because we have a saying in Michigan, in Traverse City, it's half the bay for a view of the bay. Right? And here in Indiana, when I moved to Muncie, I bought my home and met my neighbor who was a hospital official. We don't talk anymore after my college. I talked to him, and I said, what's your biggest trouble here at the hospital? He said, oh, getting docs, and we have to pay them a lot more than if they're going to live in Fishers or in Carmel, right? So the issue is that we estimated this, and these are micropolitan areas, so like Marion or Kokomo, that there's a positive correlation between quality of life and population growth. We're using the same measures, we can measure quality of business environment. There's no population growth associated with that, right? Now, that look at that number right there. It doesn't mean anything by itself. It's a 0.7. Let's look at the next slide, right? This is job growth and quality of life, right? Positively correlated. That number is 2. So quality of life's not driving population growth, it's driving job growth. People who are mobile are moving there in higher proportions, right? That's what's happening. And then quality of business environment, not so much. And so, I think the next slide is the one I want to hold off at. So what I did then is we said, I've got 600 different variables on quality of life. Everything from the average humidity in July to the average temperature in January, the variation in elevation, the amount of money we spend on schools, the crime rate, the murder rate, you name it, 600 different things. Out of those 600 things that we have, what is most highly correlated with high quality of life? So we turned on we wrote the algorithm to test that, we ran it. Number one, so we put them in three buckets. One bucket's are natural amenities, elevation change, warm Januarys, cool Julys, right? Obvious stuff. Beachfront stuff. Stuff you guys don't have, right? You got good Julys, but your Januarys suck. Except for this year, right? Your mountains, not so much, right? And then we put them into what we call private amenities, things like bowling alleys, which are negative, and golf courses, and recreational activities, and boutique restaurants, and all these different things, right? Number of churches, and those sorts of things, right? Much of those matter, okay? But it turns out economists don't worry a lot of those because those come with people, typically. And then we looked at public amenities. And of all of these 600 amenities, the number one amenity was the share of income you spend, the share of GDP you spend on schools. That's number one. Bigger than all the other 550 combined. Right? Huge factor. Crime was the higher crime rates, people don't want to live there. You want to live in places where people work from home. You don't like to live in places that are unhealthy. So you have these measures of county level, the years of potential life lost or something like that's a problem. So what's interesting about it is this doesn't tell you that high cost or low cost places matter. It doesn't tell you what, you know, I'm making no assumptions about what people like. Tipton County ends up being a high quality of life place. And so in the process of studying this, I said, I want to look at the places that had really bad natural amenities, but did really good on quality of life. And so you guys are top 10 in the country. You're right at the bottom of natural amenity measures, right? Based on what we saw on elevation change, right? Because that's got to be, what, 8 or 12 inches? From what I'm January temperature, July temperature, that sort of stuff. You're very close to the national average in July temperature, lower in January, right? And then I said, oh, that's interesting. That's really important because we're doing this for Lieutenant Governor and Oprah, this study in rural area. Tipton was a place that really sort of stuck out, that did really well in the country. Bad natural amenities, really good quality of life relative, right? So then I said, well, let's look at the places that have really bad quality of life, that had really good natural amenities. Number three there is San Francisco, right? San Francisco County is, they got the golden ticket. They got mountains, they got weather, they got view, they got ocean, they got temperature. Everything's going good for them. Their quality of life on our measure is below that of Tipton County.
Wow.
And here's why. So this takes a bit of explaining. So I just wanted to look at the relative, for Tipton County, I made two scales, relative to the USA, that's blue, and relative to the Midwest, that's the five states in the Great Lakes states area, Wisconsin, Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, Ohio. And so if we were the equal, if Tipton County was the equal of those counties, you'd be right along this 100%, you'd be exactly the same. So your measure relative to the US would be equal to 100%, just exactly that. And so these are the things that matter on our measure of post-COVID quality of life. School spending, yes, you're spending a little bit more. And this is important than the Midwest or US average. That's through property taxes. It's not through state funding, which is below the national average. But perception of school quality matters. Everybody disagrees on what good schools are, what causes them, and how to measure them, but everybody except families, they're able to sort that out pretty easily. So I try to always say this, I'm going to get mad at my teacher college people who are crazy on that. You're very close to a metro area, right? So you're very close, you're right adjacent to it. This is from county centroid to the centroid of the closest metropolitan county, right? The share of people who work at home, this is pre-COVID, this is from 2019, is much higher than national average, right? That was 2019. Years of potential life lost to disease is a little bit higher, but not far off, right? So there are counties in Indiana that are four times higher than the national average. That's a measure. And physically unhealthy days, this is the number of people who report more than three physically unhealthy days a quarter in a year that this counted by. Every 2 years, the Center for Disease Control does that. Commuting distance, about the national average. This is the Gini, it's an income inequality measure. You're better, because the lower number is better than the nation as a whole in that measure and the state. And the relative mobility of your young people, the probability that one of your young people who's born in the 1980s or 1990s would have more education or earn higher income than their parent is better than the nation as a whole. So the reason you all have higher quality of life are these factors. Some of these are policy things, right? School spending, share work at home is gonna involve how good your broadband is in some places, right? These may be the amount, how this is somewhat sensitive to public policy. That's why the governor's trying to spend more money on it. These aren't, you can't control that. So there aren't a lot of levers to pull when you're trying to fix quality of life, but you all are doing better than the nation in this, better than the national average. Certainly, top 40 counties in Indiana, top half in Indiana, so we have places that are high and low quality. Good geography. And here's my last two slides, I'm gonna hand it over to David. The world changed a lot since we were here 4 years ago, right? It was at 40 or 4 years ago, hard to tell, with the effect of COVID. The Bureau of Labor Statistics is now doing, and the census are doing surveys of people to see how many people are working from home, right? So we have here, age, categories, education, and income, and across the top here are, this is some remote, that's 1 day per week remote in the survey. This is 1 day or fewer per week working remote, so that's a 1 to 4 day, the mode is 3 days working at work. And this is nobody reporting any work from home out at work for the last 2 weeks, right? And this is Indiana, the national average is almost identical to us, right? I don't sum them up, but if you look at, here's age group, the youngs are working in remote a lot, some of us olds are as well, harder for us to adapt. Educational attainment, right? Oh no, I'm sorry, this is some remote, this is 1 day or fewer, this is fully. So almost half of college graduates are working remote. If you look down here, the numbers for much higher income, it's about half of 200,000 or more working remotely. The next graph shows I should have showed you the graph. We went from about 9% here in Tipton County. This household survey doesn't go to the county level. Right, but it's extraordinary now. About 1 in 4 Hoosier adults are working remotely right now. Right, there are more, right now, if we look at the total number of Hoosiers that are working remotely at some degree, it's about 1.1 million. Right, if that was an industry, it would be the single biggest industry Indiana has ever had. We have about 545,000 manufacturing workers. We have about 550,000 people working fully remotely in Indiana.
This is as of
I'm sorry, David, the previous slide that said associate's degree or
associate's degree in some college.
Yeah.
One category.
Does that include skilled trades, people, plumbers, electricians?
If they've been enrolled in a 2 or 4 year college,
it would.
Yeah.
If you've had some college or taken some college, but not in pre, not in secondary. So you could take a dual credit class in high school, it doesn't count. So this gives you a sense, when we're talking about where the focus ought to change, right? These are full-time and 2 to 3 manufacturer, or 2 to 3 days a week. The numbers bounce around a lot at the state level because they're not asking a lot of people, but nationally it's about 44 million workers. The national survey is really good. It's about 44 million workers. That number has actually risen over the past 6 months. So this number is from, I think, October. It's now over a million. So that number is rising pretty quickly.
But this demonstrates the magnitude. And even in Tipton County, we took all the education levels and correlated it to Tipton County. And so this is an estimate of the potential remote workers in Tipton County. Most likely we have at least that many in Tipton County. And by contrast, we compare it to manufacturing, because historically, and Mike and I, we kind of knock our heads against the wall, because a lot of our state leaders and a lot of local leaders around the state, it's almost like a habit that we default to manufacturing to solve all of our problems. And what we're trying to get through a lot of our talks, yes, manufacturing is important. Yes, we need to pay attention to manufacturing. But by orders of magnitude, we have other forces at play that really represent a larger workforce, even in our communities. And this is an example of that. So this goes to, again, if we're transitioning from that traditional approach, first of all, I always want to say, because I get economic developers chewing me out, Mike gets the school boards, I get the economic developers. The idea of business attraction is not going to go away. It's a political reality, small p political reality. You see that at the state level with IEDC and the governor, and you're going to see that at the local level forever. And you're going to see some of those policies in place that we need to rethink, but we haven't figured out how to address some of these other issues. But we also know, while that activity is going on, if communities aren't paying attention to this, they are dead in the water. They are dead in the water. And I give kudos to the Community Foundation here in Tipton County, because you've been trying to address this, trying to do a lot of these things to address this. And it really does involve engagement. Really does involve engagement. And there are communities that we've been working with for even longer than in Tipton County. You can see where they're making headway on this whole mindset. And they are probably more remote than Tipton County. And so here are some of the things that, you know, we've already talked about. Here are some of the things that we do know that are happening. We've talked about all of these different bullets. We hammered some more than others, but we've talked about all of these. But here are some of the things we don't know. And again, we don't know the pace of automation. We don't know where the expansion from metro areas is going to happen. And again, this is kind of a challenge for Tipton County to understand, because you are next to one of the fastest growing counties in the country. And I know some things are happening in Tipton County that can take advantage of that. The county in a very similar situation on the eastern part of the state is Union County. You know where Union County is? It's south of Richmond. It's next to one of the fastest growing counties in the country too. It's next to Butler County, Ohio. And we tell the folks there, don't worry about the rest of the state, pay attention to that county in Ohio.
So where does the quality of homes or quality of housing results been?
Yes, in these discussions. And I can speak more about housing, but I would think that Tipton County is one of the counties. Mike will say, and I agree with him in a lot of ways, statewide, we don't technically have a housing problem. But in certain areas of the state, there is a housing problem and housing opportunities. But it's not just housing, it's how you implement the housing.
But what percentage of people look at the homes in the community?
I'm sorry?
What percentage of people look at the homes in the community and decide if they like them or not? Or the quality of the homes or the...
They'll look at the quality of the homes, but they're also going to look at the quality of the community. It's not just the homes. It's not just the homes. There are communities that Mike lives real close to one that they have a housing initiative in a community that has 30, 40 years of declining population. And they think by building those homes, they're going to rebuild a population. But they also have poor schools. They also have poor quality amenities. They're working on it. There are also these other variables. So they're going to build these homes thinking people are going to move into those homes. They're not going to move into those homes because the community hasn't taken care of this other stuff. So it's more than just quality of housing. It's quality of community. I don't know if I'm answering your question the way you want it to answer, but that's quality of homes are important as well. And that's kind of a broader discussion. That's more of a local policy discussion that needs to happen. The phenomenon of the work from home is just, we're trying to wrap our heads around that ourselves. And that should have huge local policy implications. And you know, we're trying to help work with the mayors to help them understand that as well. So,
yes. I have a question. If you only have so much money to spend, and I'm sure that's true in virtually every community, where should the first dollars be spent?
That's a community decision.
Well, I mean,
I'm not going to go there.
Well, I mean, I think you said the schools are paramount, amenities are paramount.
They're all, those characteristics are incredibly important. And in the broader context, if you're paying attention to things like from a traditional approach, it's not an either or, it's not a zero sum game. Mm-hmm. But if you look at all of your dollars, and if you're spending all of your dollars, a huge chunk of your dollars, and tying up your tax dollars in various ways with abatement and TIF to attract a company, and you don't have the dollars to develop these other amenities and these other variables, that's where you start to get dead in the water. I'll give you an example. I live in Madison on the Ohio River. And the mayor there, the current mayor there, has done a phenomenal job of negotiating with a local company that aggressively was pushing to use all of the, they were using TIF for a big expansion of becoming a national headquarters. That's okay, that's not a bad investment. The mayor would refuse, absolutely would not bend on giving all of the TIF allocation to that company because he needed to use the TIF, a big chunk of the TIF allocation for amenity development downtown. And it's those, that's an example of what needs to be done in communities. And we need to change that mindset of accommodating the business community that is unwilling to be a partner in the community.
That strategy slide that we showed a couple more talked about community engagement. That's how you solve that problem about where you do resource allocation. Right? If you're thinking long term, the answers start getting a lot easier. If you're saying, look, it's going to take me the process of fixing this place if we don't like it or getting making it better is ongoing. So we might as well think about 20 years from now, not 2 years from now. So if you're thinking 20 years from now, you might do some really low-hanging fruit. You do a little bit of public art. Public art isn't going to move the needle. It's not going to do anything. It's sure a sign that you care about the community. It's cheap relative to other stuff. But you may, so that if you're thinking about, we're going to do this over 2 decades, and you're really thinking about it strategically like that, and everybody agrees, you walk through that, so you have a consensus, those resource allocation decisions, I think, are far easier. Planning, that's why everybody, I don't know about community planning, I don't do it, I'm a retired soldier. When we did planning, it was about resource allocation. That's all it was. It didn't matter if I was a platoon leader or chief of plans at U.S. Army Japan. It was about resource allocation. And that's what you all need to do. That's why David is hesitant to say anything, because the right answer is not knowable until you do the plan.
And I know the community and the leadership in the community have done a lot of, have had a lot of those discussions. And I know there's been a lot of debate. The debate's healthy. It's good to have the debate. That means there's an engagement process that's happening. But I think the one thing we need to understand, and that I've seen similar communities that did no planning, that was not deliberate, and the development happened to them instead of the community managing the development. There's a huge difference in quality of life. So those are the things that need to happen in community. I know this county is trying to work on that and go in that direction. So I don't know if I answered anyone's answer questions satisfactorily, but I've learned for a lot of years to get non-answers. Any other comments or questions? I think that was it. Yeah. Any other comments or questions?
Well, thank you, David and Mike. We appreciate you coming out again. And one thing that David and ICI helped us do is put together a countywide vision plan. Commissioners adopted about a year ago.
A year and a half ago.
So I would encourage you all to go out. You look at it on our website, TiptonCountyCF.org. It's a great document that does more than just tell you what the board organization did. It also gives you the process that was gone through. We got a good community engagement, came up with 5 primary goals for the county. County commissioners passed it via resolution. So take a look at that. Some of you participated in that. Some of you may have not, but that gives you a good snapshot of what was important to the people of the county. And those things haven't changed, at least the last time I looked at it. So any other questions while you guys are here? You guys have got these guys. Any other provocative questions? Yes?
You mentioned the rural worker concentration. People are grappling with it right now. Have you seen anyone?
I'm sorry, the what?
Remote worker,
yes.
Concentration. Have you seen anyone have any success with it or attempt to address growing that population or accommodating?
Growing that population?
Yeah, I mean, we have.
Like recruiting?
Yeah. we have connectivity issues here as well. So we retain residents of that work.
Connectivity is an absolute must.
High-speed internet connectivity, specifically.
Broadband, yes.
Yes,
yeah, you have to have, if you're not, if you want to be that kind of community, you have to have that. You also have to have a lot of those characteristics of community that people want. I'm more blunt than Mike is. I'm not a fan of recruitment for the sake of recruitment. It's taking that old business attraction approach and just using with individuals. And the data isn't there yet, but there are communities doing that, Make My Moves, even the state IDC's in that. And I'm curious to see that communities that gave $10,000 to these folks to move into their community, what happens after their commitment goes away? I mean, they have to stay in the community 5 years? Do they stay in the community after 5 years? And so far, the funds that have been expended, they're really just kind of marketing dollars. So if you treat it as a marketing approach, oh, okay, I can accept that. But to make a real difference in the community, make those investments in the community to make the community better. That's how I feel.
So you would grow that by making sure you can connect them to the kind of infrastructure that they need with high-speed internet.
High-speed internet.
Make the community attractive for them so that they want to be in good schools.
Yeah.
Well, think about it. So I work with all young people. They're not picking a business to go into. Every occupation we teach at the College of Business is available in 3,100 counties in America. So all these kids can live wherever the heck they want. And it may be hard for people to understand how ubiquitous it is. My daughter is an Air Force lieutenant. She has one remote work a week. Right? So the Air Force can pull off remote work. Everybody can do some of it. Right? And so think about if you're 25, right, where would you want to live? But if you like a vibrant nightlife, this probably is going to be it. Right? But if you want to raise family, what is it going to be? It should be no mystery. Right? And so those things are going to matter. The thing I will say on this is we're just beginning to understand how big a shock this is and where relocation is occurring. So I'm going to be writing a piece on the next few weeks. I looked at the map of annual population growth between 2010 and 2019, and it was fairly, normal distribution of fast-growing, slow-growing places. And then you looked at 2020 to 2021, and the colors were starkly different. So there are big winners and big losers. The effect of quality of place on migration in 1 year, 2020 to 2021, is 3 to 4 times the effect that you saw here. So it's a much starker effect. It's going to take 30 years for this to play out. Think about it. This is like the baby boom. This is a bigger shock than the baby boom in terms of where geography of work. That took 30 years to play out. So this isn't something you have to solve today. It's not like a scramble for workers today, because a bunch of them who want to work remotely are back in the office doing data for me for tomorrow. And those are the ones that you want to hire. At least they better be. And so those are the ones you want to hire. It's a long-term process. So don't feel like, oh, we don't have the housing stock we wanted, we're going to miss out. Yeah, trust me. The development's going to come here. The question is, how do you control the business? That's the question.
If you're a county of 15,000 people next to, 500,000 in Hamilton County?
380.
Okay. Exactly. It's going to happen. I mean, it's going to happen. That's what we've told people in Union County. It's going to happen. How you manage that is how you're going to succeed or not succeed. And that is going to take some time.
Another question for you. At the beginning of COVID, there seemed to be migration out of the cities because of the increased risk of infection. And people who had mobility and could work remotely, a lot of them left. Have they come back?
In the Midwest, they have. In the Midwest, so I call it the Scranton effect. Home prices in Scranton are like 40% higher than they were in 2019. If you've ever been to Scranton, there's no reason for that whatsoever, right? Except that people move from New York to Scranton because now they're working remotely and paying $1 million for a 900 square foot apartment no longer made a lot of sense. And so there are places around the coast where urban people move to micropolitan and smaller cities. But the winners of this in the Midwest have been counties in metro areas, in larger metro areas. And in part because I don't think a lot of the rural counties in the Midwest have the infrastructure to absorb those additional people. Right? So there's options for there. The other thing I'll say is I grew up in a county of 375,000 that was adjacent to a county of 15,000. And so if you want to see what could be here in 30 or 40 years, go to Loudoun County, Virginia. Go there. There was nothing there in 1970s. So that, if you go to the DC metro area, I go there. That's where Dulles Airport is, right? and there's no longer 15,000 people there. There's 15,000 people driving in any city.
It's really how you start to manage things today as a community. Yeah.
Any other questions? Now's a good time.
I just had one real quick. On your drivers of quality of place, social opportunities was right there at the top. Mm-hmm. And I think it kind of ties into the remote work thing, because those people aren't getting social opportunities at work in the way they traditionally have, but they're going to be lonely if they don't have social opportunities. And now, we're situated close to an urban metro area, but if people are wanting social opportunities in their community and not to drive to Hamilton County, what are those opportunities in 2023? Because churches are closing and like fraternal organizations aren't really in vogue. So what sort of social opportunities does Tipton need to provide?
You know, that's the kind of the conundrum, because people aren't joiners, but they also want to be engaged and they want those opportunities for that. And people do want social opportunities. And there's the idea of the third place. The first place is your home, your family. Your second place is where you work, which is also changing because of work from home. But the third place is that opportunity for socialization. It could be the preponderance of coffee shops. It could be co-working spaces. It could be public spaces where you are able to, and my colleague Brian Blackford, he uses this stuff. He talks about this and has a whole presentation on public spaces where there are, he challenges you to find 10 things to do or 10 things to engage in a public space. And so what we are working with a lot of mayors and so on, how are they creating their spaces and creating those opportunities in those communities? Some of it can be private sector driven, some of it can be public sector driven. In Brookville, and there's another, Franklin County, and there's another community there. It's again next to Butler County, just south of Union County. But there's an entrepreneur, retired entrepreneur, moved over from Cincinnati. He opened a place called Third Place. He literally called Third Place. And it's a gathering, a very popular gathering place. And it has the most amazing bourbon bar in the basement. No one knows about it, but it's pretty amazing. And there are all kinds of things going on there. But he created that space, and which also generated other activity. That's private sector. The mayor of Huntingburg, who is now the Oprah director, he saw a need for a gathering place, and he helped develop a coffee shop for people to come gather and do those kinds of things. I think it's since become private, but it depends on the community. But you have a good point. That takes a lot of community work to identify those opportunities. Did I answer your question okay?
Sure did.
Okay.
Thank you. We appreciate your help. Thank you, everybody, for attending. Linger as long as you want. Chat as long as you want. Well, almost as long as you want. Thanks again.